weeks ago, I began a four-part sermon series on the benedictions of the Bible. The benedictions of the Bible, and never preached from the benedictions before, so this is kind of a new experience for me. It's been kind of an interesting study. The word benediction comes from two words in Latin that kind of means to speak well of, okay? We would say in English, good words, or words of blessing. And there are a number of benedictions in the Bible. A benediction is more, sometimes we use the word just for a closing prayer, but a benediction is more than just a closing prayer. It includes a blessing on the people, and I'm sure some of you have attended churches or grew up in churches where at the conclusion of the worship service, the pastor would give a benediction and place a blessing upon the people. Usually when they do it, they hold their hand up. How many of you came out of churches like that? You've been a part of that experience. I think that's a great idea. I like that. And so today, I'm going to be preaching from Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21. Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21. Next week, I'm going to bring the benediction from the book of Jude. It's all of one chapter. All right? One chapter. And then in 2 weeks, I'm going to be preaching from probably the most famous of all the benedictions. It's Aaron's benediction back in the book of Numbers. The Lord bless you and keep you. That one, probably the most famous of all the benedictions. That's where I'm going to close the series on. 2 weeks ago, I did 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 23 and 24. Okay? 1 Thessalonians 5, 23 and 24, where it says, "May God himself, the God of peace," pay attention to that, the God of peace, we're going to talk about that again this morning, "sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it." It's a great benediction. Even though I don't know that benedictions are a huge part of our society today, they were a huge part of society in Bible times. You might be surprised to know that 16 out of the 27 New Testament books close with a benediction. 16 of the 27. That's a pretty large number, okay? And we'll be talking a little bit about that. Gib and Carol, welcome. I didn't see you back there until just now. Yeah, it's good to have you back after ankle replacement surgery. Ooh, that sounds kind of painful to me. Any replacements sound painful, don't they? When they replace stuff. But great to see you today. Albert Mohler, who is the president of the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky, he says this about this benediction. He writes, "This prayer might be one of the most beautiful prayers ever uttered by a Christian." This is a tremendous benediction here at the end of the book of Hebrews. We do not know who the writer of Hebrews is. Obviously, when it comes to the Bible, the author of all the books is God, but who the writer is, we're not sure who that person is. This is one of those anonymous books of the Bible, Hebrews. But in these last two verses, it expresses the writer's prayerful wish for his readers. All right. That prayerful wish for them. I've titled my message this morning, Theology 101. Theology 101. And I want to use this benediction to teach four things about God this morning. There's some tremendous theology in these benedictions. We'll see it today. We'll see it again next week. And there's four things I just want to point out to you this morning. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20 says, "May the God of peace," may the God of peace. 2 weeks ago when I spoke from 1 Thessalonians 5, 23 and 24, that's the way that benediction began. May the God of peace. That's a title for God that is given throughout the New Testament. And you'll find that title for God, the God of peace, in many of the New Testament benedictions. Now, what does it mean that he is the God of peace? You see, he could have been called other things. He could have been called the God of mercy, the God of holiness, the God of grace, the God of power. But the fact that in a lot of these benedictions, God the Father is referred to as the God of peace is something that we have to study. He's the God of peace. Peace with God comes through a relationship with God, the Son, Jesus Christ. All right. Romans 5:1 says, "Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Because of the death of God's Son, Jesus Christ, on our behalf, our sins have been forgiven, and we have peace with God. Positionally, we have peace with God. Now, until a person has made peace with God, they will never know the peace of God. Let me say that again. Until a person has made peace with God, they will never know the peace of God. That peace that Paul talks about in Philippians chapter 4, that peace that passes all understanding, that guards our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. That peace that is talked about back in Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee." Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. That's where peace with God begins. He is the God of peace. God of peace. I'll be saying more about this idea of peace in 2 weeks when I speak on the benediction of Aaron. From Numbers chapter 6, I will be speaking more on the idea of peace. What is peace? A lot of people search for peace, don't they? A lot of people today are restless. They are not at peace as we talk. And we'll talk about that in a couple weeks. So he is, first of all, the God of peace. The second thing is, he is the God of power. He is the God of power. It says, "May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus." That's power. When you can bring somebody back from death, folks, that's power. It talks about here the blood of the eternal covenant. Let's talk about what that is. What is the eternal covenant? Well, this is in contrast to the blood of the old covenant, which was made to Moses on Mount Sinai. It took the form of the law of Moses. It was a temporary covenant. This is an eternal covenant. That covenant, the sign of that covenant was all kinds of animals that had to be sacrificed in the Old Testament. All right? The old covenant. But there's a new covenant. There's an eternal covenant. It's the covenant that is mentioned in Hebrews chapter 8. I'm not going to take time to go over that this morning. It's in Hebrews chapter 8. It's also in Hebrews chapter 10, which is one of my favorite chapters in the entire Bible. What a tremendous, powerful passage it is, comparing the old covenant with the new covenant, comparing the old sacrifices of animals with the sacrifice of Jesus Christ that was only offered, that was offered once and for all. Didn't have to be repeated day after day like the, under the old covenant. One sacrifice for sin for all time. That's the eternal covenant. And the book of Hebrews is all about how Jesus, his high priesthood was so much greater, superior to the Old Testament priesthood. That's what the book of Hebrews is all about. Now, after Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, he offered it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Matthew chapter 26, 28. But the passage that I use whenever I do communion is 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25, where Jesus says, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood." Okay. It's the new covenant. It is the eternal covenant. Okay. And that's what the writer of Hebrews is talking about here. By the way, verse 20, you might be surprised that verse 20 is the only reference in the book of Hebrews to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's the only verse we have that gives us a reference to the resurrection of Jesus Christ is verse 20, the only one. This idea of he's the God of power, who through the blood of that eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, "By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also." By his power, he raised Jesus that first Easter Sunday. Raised him from the dead. A lot of people go to church on Easter. A lot of people believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. But I'm convinced there are a lot of people that go to church on Easter that do not believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And some would say, well, you know, as long as they believe this or believe this or believe this, they could be saved without believing in the resurrection. Don't fool yourself. One of these days, I'm going to preach a message on what a person must believe to be saved. The essentials of Christianity and salvation. There are certain things, folks, you have to believe in order to be a Christian. And I can tell you this morning, if you don't believe that God raised Jesus from the dead that first Easter, you are not a Christian. I don't care how much else of the Bible you believe. If you don't believe that, you're not a Christian. You say, "How do you know that, Pastor? How can you make that statement? That's pretty bold." Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says, "If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." So what does that tell us? If you don't believe that God raised him from the dead, you are not saved. There are certain beliefs that are essential for salvation. This is not a cafeteria smorgasbord where you can pick something from the Word. I'll pick something here that I believe, and, well, I don't believe this, but I'll pick this, and I believe this. No. You believe it all, or you don't believe it at all. I know that kind of goes against our politically correct society. where you just make it up as you go along. Everything's relative. You got a right to believe what you want to believe. I got a right to believe what I want to believe. And there is no absolute truth, they would tell us. I strongly disagree with that. The Bible says, sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth. There's your truth. That's what Jesus told Pilate, and that still plays today. The word is truth. Now, as we move on here, it says, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep. There's several times in the Bible where we have the imagery of Jesus Christ being a shepherd. I don't know much about shepherding. I grew up in the city. One of the lasting pictures to me back in 2009 when we went to the Holy Land and we went to Bethlehem, I'll never forget the hillside where there were shepherds keeping their sheep just outside of Bethlehem. And that's a picture that's in my mind. It's indelible. It's been there for years. I don't think it'll ever leave. And those shepherds, it just seems so biblical. You know, it's like they just took this right out of the Bible. You know, that picture. Never forgot it. Of course, those were Arab shepherds because they controlled Bethlehem. Okay. It's a little different. Here he is called the great shepherd. But other places he's called the good shepherd. He referred to himself as the good shepherd in John chapter 10, verse 11, where he said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. That's what a good shepherd does. Protects the sheep, and if need be, gives his life for the sheep. He's the good shepherd. Here he's referred to as the great shepherd because he lives for his sheep today in heaven. And he works on our behalf. He is the great shepherd. Peter calls him the chief shepherd. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4. He talks about the chief shepherd that's going to return for his sheep. So there you've got it. Past, present, and future. Because in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, it says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Past, present, future. He cares for his own sheep. Past, present, future. That's why David could say in Psalm 23:1, what's he say? The Lord is my shepherd. He makes it personal. How many of you think David knew a little bit about being a shepherd? He knew a little bit about this idea of when he said, the Lord is my shepherd, he knew exactly what he was talking about, what he was referring to. David was a shepherd himself. He is the God of peace. He is the God of power. Third, he is the God of provision. He's the God of provision. Look at verse 21. That great shepherd of the sheep will equip you with everything good for doing his will. He's the God of provision. He will equip you with everything good for doing his will. How many of you say, I think that's pretty neat. I want God to equip me for everything that I need to do his will. How many of you say, that would be a great prayer? Now, where in the Bible do we see that that is backed up, that he will equip us for everything good in doing his will? We see it in James chapter 1, verse 17, where it says, every good and perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of the heavenly lights, in whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. If it's good, it's God. It's good as God. And he's going to equip us for everything good for doing his will. 2 weeks ago, a verse that I told you was a life-changing verse in my own life was Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. For it is God who works in us to will and to do of his good pleasure or purpose. If you want to do God's purpose in your life, if you want to bring God pleasure by your life, all you have to do is pray for God to put that desire in you. He'll give you everything that you need in order to do his will. Isn't that a tremendous promise? He's going to equip you to do his will. I take great satisfaction in that because I don't have to do this on my own. I got a lot of help. I have an equipper. An equipper. God will do whatever it takes to give us whatever we need, whenever we need it, so that we can do his will. And the Greek word that's used there for equip is a beautiful word, katartizo, katartizo. And the word is used four different ways in the Bible, and I like all four. Let me give you some word pictures here of this idea of equip, katartizo. It was used of soldiers being equipped with weapons and training that was needed for battle. That was a context in which this word was used. That makes sense. It was used of sailors loading their ships with goods for the trip. When they would set sail, they would load and they would equip that boat for their trip. It was used in the medical profession of doctors that would set a broken bone so that it would heal. And last, it was used of fishermen who were mending their nets. Now, let's look at those last two illustrations. They both refer to restoring something that is broken in order to use it again. May God equip you. May God put your broken pieces back together so that you can become useful again, is what the writer is saying here. To take those broken pieces, and just like setting a bone or mending a net, he's going to put those things back to their original condition so that they can be used again. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Going to equip you. Now, some may wonder, how does God equip us with everything good for doing his will? How does he do that? What is involved in that process of his equipping us with everything that we need to do his will? Three things. He does it, first of all, by his word. He equips us through his word. We have 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped, katartizo, right there, equipped for every good work. He uses his word to equip us. So what happens to the person that doesn't spend time in the word? They are not fully equipped. That's a very dangerous place to find yourself. Because basically you're on your own at that point. You haven't been equipped. How else does God equip us with everything that we need in order to do his will? It starts with the Word of God. Secondly, it moves to the fruit of the Spirit. In Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, we have listed there the fruit of the Spirit, those nine character qualities that are there. The Holy Spirit is always trying to produce those nine character qualities in us. He is equipping us as far as our character, all right? The Holy Spirit does that. How else does God equip us with everything that we need to do his will? He gives us spiritual gifts or a spiritual gift. And you can read about those spiritual gifts in Romans chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, where they're listed. And the Bible in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 teaches that if you are a Christian, you have at least one spiritual gift that God, that the Spirit has given to you. And he distributes them to each one individually as he chooses. That's what the Bible says. That's why some people may have more spiritual gifts than other people. It's all on the Holy Spirit as to how he distributes them. But if you're a Christian today, you have at least one spiritual gift. And that one spiritual gift or more is given to you for the edification of the body of Christ so that we all may come to the place of maturity. It's for that spiritual gift was given to you to be used to build up the body of Christ, to encourage the body of Christ, so that we all can become more spiritually mature. So the question on the floor is, do you know what your spiritual gift is? And the follow-up question is, are you using the spiritual gift if you know what it is? I think one of the saddest things in the church is people who have been saved for a long time, but they've never discovered what their spiritual gift is. It's been laid dormant for many, many years. Never used. Never used. So God equips us through those three ways, through the Word, through the fruit of the Spirit, and through spiritual gifts. Those are the three biggest ways that he equips us. Fourth thing that I want you to see is he's the God of purpose. He's the God of purpose. Equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him. That's his purpose. He's a God of purpose. He wants to work in us what is pleasing to him. I started to think about this week, and I started to think, you know, that would be a good sermon sometime. What does the Bible say pleases God? What that we can do, what does the Bible specifically say these things please God? Anybody here want to please God? That's quite a question, you know. Is your life, is the chief thing in your life to please God? It should be. Then I would ask a follow-up question. Not is the chief thing in your life to please God, but is your life currently pleasing to God? And what does that mean? What does that look like to please God? Let me give you just a few quick thoughts. Romans 8:8 says something. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. About that one. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. How many people do you know of that are controlled by the sinful nature? Hebrews 11:5. That great Faith Hall of Fame chapter. Hebrews 11:5 talks about a man from the Old Testament by the name of Enoch, who appears in Genesis chapter 5. Enoch is one of two men in the Bible that went to heaven without dying. Enoch was not, because God took him away. That's what the Bible says. He was not found because God took him. You can imagine, search parties went out looking for Enoch. His family was trying to figure out where he went, and they couldn't find him because God took him away. Back in Genesis chapter 5, Enoch is described as a man who walked with God. But in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5, after Enoch had been taken away, the Bible says, before Enoch was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. It is possible to live a life that pleases God. Enoch pulled it off, and guess what? He got that trip to heaven without ever dying. The other guy who got the trip to heaven without dying was Elijah. In 2 Kings chapter 2, he was in a fiery chariot, and the horses were on fire. Think about this. That separated Elijah from Elisha. There were horses that were on fire, and he got in his chariot, and the chariot went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Wow, what an entrance. Man, what a trip that would have been. But it says of Enoch that he was commended as one who pleased God. Now, the next verse, get the context here. The next verse, Hebrews 11:6 says, and without faith it is impossible to please God. That's right after it talks about Enoch, who was commended as a man who pleased God. Well, without faith, you're not able to do that. That's the importance of faith. The importance of faith. What else pleases God? Colossians chapter 3, verse 20 says, children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. And all the parents said, when children are obedient to their parents, they are actually being obedient to the Lord, and that pleases him. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 16 says something else that just a few verses back. And do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased. God is pleased when we do things that are good. God is pleased when we share some of our stuff with those who are in need. God is pleased by that. I think of Peter in Acts chapter 10. He had arrived at the home of the centurion Cornelius the Gentile. And Peter is telling Cornelius and his household about this Jesus of Nazareth. But Peter doesn't want to get real wordy, so he kind of summarizes the life of Christ by saying this: Jesus of Nazareth went about doing good. Pretty short, pretty simple. If you want to describe and define the life of Christ, he went about doing good. Why? Because that pleases the Father. that we would do good. Verse 16 says that. We are not saved by works, but my friends, we are saved to work. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, right after it says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. It's not of works, lest any man should boast." But then Ephesians 2:10 comes back, just in case you would feel, well, there's no value in doing good works. It says, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God in advance has decided for us to do." There's a place for good works. And good works done with a good motive, good works done with a good heart, please God. Please God. The year was 1860. A baby was born in England. His name was Charles Thomas Studd, S-T-U-D-D. He would go through his life being called C.T. That was his nickname. C.T. Studd went to Cambridge University, became one of the greatest college cricket players in the world. He graduated from college and he was offered a pro cricket contract that he would have been one of the highest paid players in all of England. He turned it down. When he graduated from Cambridge, he became a part of the what had been later called the Cambridge Seven, and this group dedicated themselves to going and being missionaries. So for the first 15 years after he graduated from Cambridge, he went to China and worked with Hudson Taylor, the founder of the China Inland Mission, for the first 15 years. During the time he was in China, C.T. Studd's father died. And his father was extremely wealthy. He gave C.T. an inheritance to where C.T. would have never had to work a day in his life. C.T. Studd did not take one penny from the inheritance. He sent it to three of his favorite causes. He sent one-third of that inheritance to Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. He sent one-third of it to George Mueller. If you remember, George Mueller ran the orphanage in Bristol, England, operated strictly on faith. He never once asked for any money to run his orphanages. He just prayed to God to provide. When George Mueller died, he had taken in over 9,000 orphans and provided, God had provided for all of his needs. C.T. Studd was a man who decided from the very beginning, I'm going to live my life by faith, not finances. To trust God. The third group that he gave his inheritance to, a third part of the inheritance, was to the Salvation Army in India. And after serving as a missionary at China Inland Mission for 15 years, the next 6 years, he went on to be a missionary in India. And he finished his life at the age of 70, dying from untreated gallstones. He finished his life, the remainder of his life, as a missionary in Africa. China, India, Africa. At that time, in the 1800s, some of the toughest mission fields in the world, and he went to all three of them. Now, why do I tell you this? C.T. Studd understood doing good works that please God. But I remember as a boy, my mom quoted her favorite poem to us many, many times as boys growing up. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. It wasn't until years later, after my mom quoted that to us and I had left home, that I found out that C.T. Studd was the one that wrote that poem. Makes perfect sense, doesn't it? Ask you to stand as I read this closing benediction. Hopefully our theology that he's the God of peace, he's the God of power, he's the God of provision, he's the God of purpose. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 20 says, may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever.